Hey, 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 it's Shop Talk, baby. This is the show where it's okay to be you. We're talking from Yale to jail and from the church house to the pib house. Nothing's excluded on Shop Talk. So if you don't have a phone, I suggest you borrow one. Call in and voice your opinion live every Saturday morning from 10 a.m. to 12 noon. Yeah, that's right, 10 a.m. to 12 noon. Don't forget to Shop Talk with your girl, because right here, oh, we keep it real.
Welcome to Shop Talk with Mel. I am your girl, Mel, and we have the lovely co-host, Amber D, in the building. Got a great show planned for you today. Yes, we do. We have a guest coming on, author Monica Phillips, and today's topic, as I usually, let's just throw it on up here real quick. Throw it on up here. Where are we at here? There we go. Church hurt. Church hurt. It's a thing. What you think, Amber D?
It's definitely a thing. Definitely. Especially if you grew up in church.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
If you grew up, it's a thing. It's a thing. And we're going to talk to her a little later in the show. We're going to address this Shop Talk question of the week real quick. Y'all let me know what you think. Matter of fact, let me go ahead and put this up here. If you want in on this conversation, go on and get your ink pens now. Get your EPs and log it in your phone right now. The phone number here is 619-902-2287. 619-902-2287. 877-207-8787. Feel free to call in and voice your opinion live, or you can text. It's totally up to you. When you text, I don't usually say the name, but if you want to voice your opinion live, I say, okay, you ain't never scared, so let's get this let's get this Shop Talk question of the week out of the way real quick, okay? All right. So, when you divorce your partner, do you divorce the family too?
I think it depends on your relationship with the family. I feel like for a lot of people, it's like hit and miss. Like, it's not the entire family you're divorcing.
Okay.
It's not the entire family you're keeping. So, if you've had, or maybe, you know, something I've observed is that people will divorce and then, you know, they'll kind of fall back, or they may not know if the family or certain family members wish to continue to have a relationship with that person. So that definitely creates confusion, but I would say it's definitely, there's no hard and fast rule, and maybe, you know, you're doing whatever is best for your own mental health. But I think if there's someone or a handful of people from your ex-spouse's family you'd like to keep in touch with, there's nothing with trying to keep those, maintain those relationships even after the divorce.
You're like, okay, yeah, that's all I got. But here's the thing. You have people, family members that be upset that, you know, we keep the other people.
Well, we didn't marry them and we didn't divorce them either. So I think it's especially if you got kids together.
Like, yeah, if you have children. Kids
together, then I'm going to need you to A, suck it up and get over it. And it's what's beneficial for the children is for everyone to at least be civil and still be cohesive, even though your marriage failed.
Like, okay, the cookout, the family cookout, the family reunions.
Yeah, keep it civil, keep it pleasant. It's all love. You know, like I said, you weren't married to him. You don't know what went on behind closed doors. So why would you have a vested interest in that when being blood related to somebody doesn't indicate what their character is?
Okay. I can remember. Yeah. So you wouldn't be upset? I mean, if your situation was different, you wouldn't be upset that you're, every time you come with your new person, this ex is here?
If we got kids together and he wants to come and he has a good relationship with some people in my family, you know, it's one of those things you just got to suck it up and swallow it. That's life. You're going to be swallowing S-H-I-T sometimes. But that's a part of, you know, having a blended family. You can't just, outside of abuse, you're going to have to, like, be around them because y'all got kids together to an extent, you know?
That's something to think about, though. And a lot of people don't look at that. So you're the new person that's coming on the scene that he's dating, and his ex is there. And they have children, and they are now adults. The children are adults.
Okay.
Tell me about that. Clearly it happened. Look, clearly it happened. That's why it's a Shop Talk question of the week.
Right, yeah. It's definitely something that happens. And I, like I said, if your extended family and your ex are, you know, in a good relationship and they were invited by whoever's hosting the event, then it is what it is. I mean, if you have an issue with it, you should be bringing that concern to the host. Like, I'm really uncomfortable with inviting
this. And you know, the family reunions are committees. You're talking about the host. That's a whole committee. How many people you got to go through?
Bring it to the committee. Bring your written complaints to the committee. Okay. But, you know, it's just like, I don't think when y'all got kids together, especially if the kids done came, because maybe your kids wanted their other parent to come, then what?
But if they're adult children, so you're talking like 20, 25, they're married, and
maybe they're like, oh, I know I've done this. We do it a lot in my family. Like, we haven't seen each other, but we're going to link up at the next family get together. So please come. Like, that'll be a good opportunity for, you know, me to see this person and that person. I can knock out a whole bunch of birds in one stone.
So as the new person, so you're dating somebody. Now watch this. So you're dating somebody and you guys are clearly serious. But I don't know, cats be taking everybody to the reunion. Every 2 to 3 years is somebody different, okay? So what do you do in that case?
Because we've talked about this before. I wouldn't take it that serious, okay? Because, yeah, I mean, men in my own family bring around different women every family. I'm just like, okay. So he doesn't mean y'all serious. Even if he's saying that, I don't know. You know, when the ring is on my finger is when I'm going to take it serious.
Uh-huh.
But if I'm a new girl and we're serious and he brings me around his family and then his baby mama or whatever, or ex-wife, mother of his children, is at the event, I am going to look at that situation as an opportunity to collect data. Probably some real good intel. So, that's just going to influence my perception of him and our relationship and what I thought it was. And, you know, like that. That's how I look at it, as an opportunity to collect more information.
Okay.
Especially if y'all are just starting to get serious. It's not like you're married to him.
Right.
You know, you're dating.
Right. So, do you feel like if the person whose family it is feels like that they don't want their ex there, even though they introduced you. Look, you're the one that brought me to these people, okay? That's the thing that cracks me up. It's like, okay, you introduced them to the family, and we like them, and then, like you said, aside from abuse, and then you don't like them anymore, whatever happened there, then we supposed to not like them? Like, how does that work?
I would just be like, ambivalent. You know, I'm Switzerland. So I was just like, I'm not taking nobody's side unless there's kids involved. In that case, I'm like, I'm gonna need you to get over it. Like, I don't care. I'm not in your marriage, like, or what your relationship was.
Uh-huh.
Like, you know, they got invited somehow, some way. I'm sure your kids want to see their other parent. So let's just be civil for this next 2 hours.
Now, I'm talking about adult children, though.
4 hours.
I'm talking about adult children, though. Uh-oh, I lost her. There you go.
Even your adult children.
You know, even like, adult children, too? Okay.
You know,
I said even adult children, too?
Yeah.
You're good?
Yeah, even adult children.
Okay, so just suck it up. That's the answer.
Yeah, I just feel like we should all be moving towards, being copacetic.
Okay.
You know, and unless baby mama, ex-wife is, you know, causing a scene, what's the problem?
Let's hope that's not the case. Look, I'm like, let's hope that's not the case. Yeah. All right. I just wanted to get it out there. It was a whole lot of people that was like, no, if you divorce me, you divorce my family. That's how they feel.
But that's your family, individuals of your family determine. You don't get to determine other people's relationship with another human being.
Yeah. No, that's true.
You can share your feelings. You can share how it made you feel. You can tell them you feel like you're choosing the ex-spouse over them, that decision is now putting strain on your relationship with that family member. But no, you don't get to control how other people interact with another person.
Ah, well, there you have it. Let's get this show on the road. All right, we got some hot topics, honey, some hot topics. We're going to talk about, matter of fact, let's just roll with it. We'll just go on down the line.
All right.
Okay, Anita Baker. We got the Anita Baker fans out there. Now, what I see is happening with the artists now is old artists, because good music, the artists are coming back like, oh, wait, we're not done. You know, because usually you make room for the new artists. Well,
I feel like they were maybe forced out, not made room.
You think?
Know, the powers that be were like, you're washed up and old, and now we want someone young and spicy.
Oh, the committee. The committee. The committee said, you're out of there. The committee's like, oh, yeah, you're out. Whoa. I just got to share this. Anita Baker, this was earlier in the week, like, what, Wednesday, I think. She was in Newark, New Jersey, and she was supposed to be with Babyface. Now, yeah, I like old school. Am I a big Anita Baker fan? I'm not. But she paved the way for the Toni Braxtons. You know what I mean? Because you kind of had that same vibe. However, comma, like I said, it was her with Babyface. So they could have, he has a huge catalog, but she was the headliner and he was performing with her, which I thought was amazing. Because, you know, sometimes people be upset with who headlining and all that other stuff, which pretty much boils down to who gets paid the most. Well, Anita Baker decides that Babyface, and you know, he has written for a lot of people, that Babyface couldn't perform because she needs to do her show in its entirety. Now watch this.
Wasn't enough time, right?
But here's the problem, though. You want to do the show in its entirety, but you were too. The show was 2 hours late, alleged. Like, come on, don't Lauryn Hill us.
Now that's something else I've heard, seen. Not just Anita Baker allegedly, but also Lauryn Hill allegedly and Chaka Khan allegedly. And I feel like also Erykah Badu allegedly. You know, having shows that were so late and just unprofessional and disrespectful to fans and fans' time. So she's not the only one. I've definitely heard of that as far as these, like, old heads.
And she whispered it. She's like, old heads.
You know, and, you know, doing stuff like that. And I feel like if she, you know, with her, you know, creative integrity or whatever, felt like she needed to do the whole show on her own, or she needed that much time to do, and obviously the concert was booked for X amount of time, I think it's a reasonable complaint or critique. You know, like, I want to give this complete show to my fans.
Okay.
But then on the flip side, you're 2 hours late, so it kind of, like,
Yeah, that's kind of foul. And honestly, I'm not there for Anita Baker. I would be there to see Babyface, so I would feel some type of way. Well, Babyface went to Twitter, and he actually let it be known that, listen, this is what occurred. That's how I got that information, from Babyface's Twitter post. It was not him, and it's not like he didn't show up, because I guess he don't want to be associated with being unprofessional. Sure. Now, when you bring up Chaka Khan, and even like Erykah Badu, you have people who really like her. I just, you know, it's a few of them, you know, that neo soul, you got to really like it. But I think it's just so disrespectful to waste someone's time and have them waiting for you to perform. I understand glitches, but tell me something and tell me the truth. She is not here at this time, so we're still waiting on her and we're trying to entertain you. We're trying to entertain you until they come, because it puts the promoter...
Ooh, that's what I was
going to
say.
Yeah, it puts them in a bad light. It puts your MC, whoever is hosting, you know what I mean, you're MCing it. It puts them in a bad light because you're looking real crazy, been there.
Yes.
And it's like, now I got to come up with something. Let's see. Let me communicate, because the professionals back here that you came to see did not respect you enough to be here on time. I'm saying it. And like you said, like with Chaka Khan, I figured, like, when you air quotes for the listening audience, the old heads, I think that they would really be on time. Like, old people get up real early. You hear me? They get up real early. Like, do the show in the afternoon.
Right. No,
maybe they took a nap.
Yeah, but I've heard it with so many different old celebrities. It's just like, yeah, it's a thing.
And it's sad that I would expect the younger person to be like late. They're probably kicking it, partying, like, oh my goodness. And I I charge that to like irresponsibility. I'm not grouping you all into like one group, but I'm just saying what I'm saying. But as an adult, as an old head, you should be happy somebody even buying your tickets, ma'am.
Well, and I think that like that's the perception, but I feel like the difference is that the young artists are more money hungry and they're more in that go-getter energy. So they're like, no, let's go get this money. Where the old head has already had their money. They've already experienced success, wealth, and fame. They already got their money. So now it's just the passion that's carrying them. But, you know, maybe they have some physical limitations or some other issues that they're dealing with, which is now a bigger part of their psyche because they've already hit those milestones.
Okay. Okay.
And I feel like that's probably why the younger artists are more professional, because they're more focused on the money, whereas an old head artist can actually just be focused on the craft.
Well, and I appreciate being focused on the craft. I appreciate being dressed properly, because I don't want to get dressed up to see you with some t-shirt on and it's wrinkled, look like it was over on the floor, balled up. Okay, yeah, I'm here's a message for you. Okay. You know what I mean? I appreciate people being dressed to perform. Like, I paid to see you. I didn't pay to, you know, I paid to see you to, I paid to see a new outfit. New fashion, because that's what I go for. Let me see what's new. You remember, I used to watch, like, the videos just to see what was new in fashion. Mm. Not, don't come up here with no old t-shirt on. Got me waiting all day and some jeans. And my outfit looked better than yours, like I should be performing. That's a problem for me with the younger people. Now, the older ones, yeah, they got their money and their fame, but I'm thinking that it probably, their money ran out or is running out.
Yeah, definitely.
And they see that there's a place and that there's people out there, the concert goers, that want to pay to see. Mm-hmm. And most of the new artists followed in the footsteps or admired old artists. So they want to see them. I think it was just rude. It was just rude to me. And Anita Baker, like I said, matter of fact, she was the last person to apologize. I think, was that her last album, like in 83 or something? I don't know. Come on.
Yeah.
But Babyface, I would have paid to see Babyface, and I would have been upset leaving there, and a lot of people were upset, and they were leaving.
Okay. I don't know what's happening, but tell me why. It was in my dream, a Babyface song was playing, and this morning, I couldn't get out of my head. And you know the best way to get a song out of here is like, listen to it, and I still haven't listened to it. And I don't remember, and you probably know it, but it's like, dun, 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 dun.
Dun, 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 dun. Let you give it a, we can't do that thing, we gotta pay for it.
Cupid. I don't even know the words.
But
that's
Cupid.
Okay, yeah. And so it was playing in my dream, and then I woke up and it was in my head, and now we're talking about him. Isn't that funny?
How about that? Got what you got. There you go. Yeah, that's Cupid. I don't know if he wrote that. Did he write that?
I thought he did.
Oh, okay, we'll see, because he wrote. He has a huge catalog, but at least it wasn't the Whip Appeal. Linen Change. Hey, what about our guy in Nashville, Tennessee, the hotel manager that got caught sucking the guests' toes?
I saw that.
Well, he had his day in court.
Okay.
He had his day in court, and the accused said that he smelled smoke, so that's why he went in the room.
His hot body.
Now listen, you smell smoke, so you go into this guest's room. That still does not explain why his toes was in your mouth, sir. Help me understand what's happening.
That's crazy. Was it like,
I don't know what it was like. I don't think it could be anything. The man sued, okay? But look, and this happened back, we talked about this was back in March, the end of March. So now he had his day in court. That's what he's standing on, that he smelled smoke. I don't know what happened after because it's his word against the person's word.
Right.
The guest word.
I mean, that's why I'm just like, I feel like there's more to it. Like,
you think there's more to it?
Yeah, like, just from what I have read about, like, closeted homosexuals and that whole, and just, like, adulterers and things. Like, anytime you're doing anything that's supposed to be inconspicuous or whatever, you know, someone can feel some type of way, and so they backpedal and back out and be like, this wasn't consensual.
Well, when you're in that position and you're at work, like, you can't just be coming up here.
I completely agree.
You know, sucking toes on your lunch break. I just, like, help me understand what's happening here.
I mean, I'm just, because it's like, has he done it before? Has there
history? Yeah, you have all those questions.
It just, it generates a lot of questions. Like, does he have a history of having inappropriate interactions with guests? I mean, and I would think
listen,
about,
I think they would have put that out, because this is a, I won't say the name of the hotel because y'all might be thinking that it's a chain of, oh gosh, this is what they do. You guys look it up, but it was Nashville, Tennessee, and it's a hotel manager, night shift hotel manager. I thought that there had to be some type of conversation or something prior to, because it just seemed weird, but it can happen where you could be in your room and somebody could come in. That's why it is so important to put that little latch on that door. And I don't want to have you guys paranoid or anything like how I be over the top, because I'm like, maintenance got the key to every room. I'm in the shower. Like, no, we'll figure this thing out. So just make sure you protect yourself, because, you know, God forbid, you don't want to wake up to wet feet. Go ahead. What you got?
This is a second one. I'm going to Nashville for our family vacation this summer. Look at that.
Look at, girl, you better put that latch on that door for all, shoot. Amber D, be careful now.
Right, yeah, I feel like there was a conversation had before, or maybe he went to the wrong room, or
you don't go to the wrong room and suck the wrong person's toes now. I'm not going to get past that.
I don't know, it's just very confusing.
It definitely is and can be. Now, let's talk about Jamie Foxx. Let's clear this up. Now, see, it's so many different outlets, and you got to make sure that you check the right one. Well, the daughter spoke out, and they were like, oh, people are coming. They're calling the family up. The daughter spoke out, and this is according to TMZ, so I'll tell you where I got this source from. So you check with them if it's different. I'm praying for them. We don't know what's going on with them. I was concerned, not as far as like, well, yes, I was. What was going on with him? Because I need to know if it's something that's out in the environment. You know, people be trying to have secrets and stuff like that. And I'm like, no, I need to know. Let me protect myself. What happened to him to just one day hear it and bam, this happens? Let me know if it's something going on. You know how we got hit with the COVID.
Right.
Let me know, please, so I can protect myself. And now they have it where you don't have to wear masks anymore. And even at hospitals, it's like, no, we don't want to do that. And then you have some hospitals that feel like if you wear your mask, you're offending the patient.
Well, that's a part of American culture for sure.
Right. It is. And that's how it was pre-COVID as well. Like, you're offending the patient. Well, we wasn't offending the patient like 2 to 3 years ago. Like, help me. You know what I'm saying? Right. So, let me get COVID because of your feelings.
Right. Yeah. See, I feel like it's like two sides of the same coin. You know, they'll talk about snowflake culture, but then they'll use snowflake arguments. Like, oh, it offends me because I want to exercise my constitutional right not to wear a mask. But because you're choosing to wear a mask on your own face, my feelings are hurt.
Okay. How do you feel in this? Like, we're darned if you do, darned if you don't. We can't figure it out. You know what I mean? And that's why his daughter actually came out and said, hey, my dad is at home. He's been at home. So whatever you heard, you heard.
Well,
so I guess we should just sit back and just wait to the final, the final comment is out there and listen to the family. But go ahead, what you got?
I've read some criticism of the daughter, and I agree, because no one knew that he had been hospitalized until, you know, his family, daughter, whatever, brought it to social media.
Mm-hmm.
And then according to the timeline I read, because this was not a story I've really been following, then she came out recently and posted and said that he's fine, he's out of the hospital, and he hasn't been in the hospital for weeks. And it's like, well, but you just, but the timeline of the post that she's made would, you know, indicate like that, okay, so why did you wait weeks for to tell people that? When you initially you brought it to the public's attention by posting the information, then you gave an ask. You asked people to pray for him, and if you're actually a spiritual or religious person, if you are a prayer warrior and you have his fans and people that care about him genuinely praying for his healing and well-being, why would you not take the time to inform those prayer warriors that he's been released from the hospital? And then turn around and also state that, oh, respect our privacy, stay out of our business, when you brought the business to social media. And then not only that, you're insulting the people that genuinely cared.
Okay. That's a good point. That's a great point, actually, especially when you're dealing with not just Jamie Foxx, but just people in general, where they're like, pray for my family. What's up with the pray for my family, don't ask no questions?
Yeah, that doesn't, I mean, I learned that in church. So again, it's like, if you're, depending on your upbringing or your religious denomination, it makes it a lot less effective if you don't know what exactly you're praying for. And so, and I feel like a part of that is the transparency. Something else I also came across on social media was the comparisons between Jamie Foxx's situation and Bruce Willis's situation. And so I see the difference, because I feel like his family has, they got ahead of it, basically.
Okay.
And said that we're releasing the information. Same also with that one country music star, the Judds, when her mother completed suicide and the daughters chose to get in front of it and tell the public what happened. And I'm not a country music fan. So basically sharing that she had a very many years long struggle with depression. And so, you know, those two families kind of controlling the narrative of what happened, what was going on with their loved ones. And then with Bruce Willis, I had never heard of the disease he's suffering with. And, you know, his family's documenting it. And you can see that, you know, what is it? Say his ex-wife moved back in with them to help for him and stuff. And it's just a completely different dynamic than all this, like, secrecy and, like, stay out of our business, but pray for us with Jamie Foxx. It's a difference.
It's a big difference. And
because, again, I feel like they're focusing on the naysayers and the gossipers and the blog sites, whereas, like, Bruce Willis's family is focusing on the people that actually care, the fans that actually cared about Bruce Willis, and they would want
to. And I can appreciate that.
And you know, keep him in their thoughts and prayers as he's, you know, and any degenerative brain disease is, like, horrible. So,
well, listen, us here, we here at Shop Talk with Mel are not saying he got a brain disease. So let's be clear on that. We talk about Bruce Willis real quick, even though we started with
Jamie Foxx.
Okay. We got a guest today, and I'm going to try to bring her on. This is the author, Monica Phillips. Of her book is called This Is My Exodus. Let me see. Is Monica on? Monica, are you on?
She's on mute.
Okay, let's see if we can get. I guess I'll have to wait. So when she comes on, we'll continue until we get her going. Okay, and see her camera. Yeah, we'll let her get that together. Kim Zolciak, Kim Zolciak and Croy.
Baby.
Listen. How in the world? Like, you done got all the, you done multiplied. You been fruitful, multiplied. Now, when he was in the NFL, you're like, okay, this is my guy. You got your Real Housewives money. Then you do your spinoff show, Tardy for the Party or somebody. And then you have these children, so you drop them off.
The turns.
Yeah. And then you take your two older children and he adopts them. And now you want to divorce him, and he's going for child support.
Well, the rumors and speculation that I've been seeing is that, you know, some infidelity may be at the root of it. And basically for, I mean, it's a whole new day and age now. You got men filing for alimony and full custody, so they ain't got to pay child support, things like that.
Alleged. You said alleged infidelity.
Alleged infidelity.
Okay.
And so it could be that he's trying to avoid child support, because that's a lot of kids. It's a lot of children.
That is a lot. But usually if you're going to file for it, she must have been the one that...
Right. And that's what people are saying, is that, you know, it must have been bad for him to want full custody of all them kids. And
okay.
And also, once the divorce is filed, allegedly, that she's not allowed in the home no more. He wants a restraining order after the divorce. After everything is settled with divorce, he don't want her in the house, not to be allowed in the house, allegedly.
Listen, if he gets awarded custody, baby, that child support, they gonna lay her to rest. Like right, night.
Allegedly. Drug use. So people are basically saying what you said. It must be something bad.
I would think so. I think that, you know, even him, watching him on the show, he was younger, obviously, but watching him on the show, it seemed like he really wasn't even into all of that, you know, pomp and circumstance reality thing. Yeah, he really wasn't into it, but he did it for her. And now, boom, you pay. He don't have that NFL money, but he probably, you know, his family was, well, from the country. Wasn't he a farm boy? So I know that.
He came from a pretty, like, comfortable
family. A farm boy. I don't know why people think farm people is not, or farmers is not rich. Yeah, that's so far from the truth. But right. Then, like, with morals, values, I think he has all of that. I mean, I don't know about her personally, but what I saw and what was exhibited, even with his family, that really wasn't for him marrying her, but he did what he wanted to do. Mm-hmm. I saw a solid foundation. So I think, you know, if the public opinion, I would think that, yeah, that's probably the best. Even though she can, like, she can make some money. She can go back.
I feel like she's a hustler, and she has a hustler's mentality.
Uh-huh.
As far as the stability,
uh-huh,
and the foundation, I don't think is there, because I know there was, I remember reading criticism of her and her, you know, giving her daughter plastic surgery at like 16 or something. And for his accountability, for male accountability,
uh-huh,
he chose her. Okay. He knew her history. He knew she was a mistress and he was okay with that. And he chose to marry her. Already had children, was a sugar baby.
Who was a sugar baby? Her? He,
yeah, you know,
he was, because
well, he's a, yeah,
because he was younger,
and he was her sugar baby. And then another thing I had read about that I thought was interesting was that I guess one of his arguments or her arguments involved in the divorce was that he had a difficulty finding his place as the head of household. In, you know, in this busy household with all of these children.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, you know, stepping up to the mantle of manhood, basically. And so Kim allegedly went and got a new sugar daddy, right? And so, because that's...
That's right, because she was with, what was his name, Big Poppy or Papa?
Big Papa was his alias. So apparently after allegedly gambling, allegedly big debt until she went and got another sugar daddy.
All to help her family out. All right. Well, y'all keep watching. There's too much time on her. Let's go with Salvage of YouTube. Go ahead, Amber D.
They lit for show. Keep up the great work, farmers. Yes, they have, from what I remember, it was like he came from a pretty well-to-do, okay family, like money-wise. Like, he wasn't poor. So, but he wasn't on Big Papa's level.
Clearly.
Allegedly.
But she was in love with it. She was in love with this guy at the beginning, and she got all them souvenirs and all that. Anyway, that's enough of them, and we're going to see. But if he, like I said, if he gets custody, baby, she probably going to pass out unless she get another sugar. She get a sugar daddy, like you said, and then she'll be fine. Jay-Z. You see Jay-Z back in the news. There is an alleged child that's coming out and saying that he's his father. You are the father.
The caption I saw was that he got DNA to prove that he's not this person's father. And it's like, leave me alone and get on my face.
Okay, so so that's the caption you saw. What I've read on several outlets was he's refusing to do it.
He's refusing to do DNA.
He's refusing to do the DNA. And the guy's like, you know, come on. I want to get this test done. And he's taking it up all the way, to the Supreme Court, I think I read on one of them. He wants to go all the way up to get this DNA done, where allegedly Jay-Z is refusing to do it. And that sounds more accurate than you did it. Now, the other girl, remember the one she found out from Ancestry.com? The daughter, it was a daughter a few years back. Uh-huh. She did the Ancestry.com, and then she was a match with his aunt and all that other stuff. And then it came out, you know, that was his daughter. But now you have other people. So I guess everybody is doing what they do. Like, let me see who my people are. And I don't even think it's with this young man, to be honest with you, because he's an adult. I think it's more so peace of mind. Like, and not wanting something from him, like, you know what I mean?
And if he did want something from him, oh well. Again, accountability. Men dropping their seeds off everywhere. Oh well, now we're in a new day and age. There's DNA, there's ancestry.com, you know,
that ancestry.com.
Oh well. So let the truth ring, whatever that may be. But that reminded me of a video that was going around of this young lady saying that she was the love child of Denzel Washington.
Now, we know that stuff was bogus. Everybody doing what they do for attention. I can't even give her that. I can't even give her a platform. Nope, we stopping that one. Nope, okay. Get out of here. Because that's like the others, too, with the Janet Jackson and DeBarge guy. Mm-hmm. Bye. No, we're not doing it. This one, I'm feeling, and okay. I want to see the outcome. And I really feel like it's just for a peace of mind, because I think the daughter, her mom was like really sick or something like that.
Okay.
And I'm thinking, you know, these people will probably come out because, you know, okay, you became a star. But think about all the local rappers or people felt, you know, back in the day when you're trying to make a come up and you just slept with somebody backstage and oops, not saying that they were that chick. You know what I mean? Their parents were that girl. But you just don't know. Monica, you with us?
Yes.
All right. Yes, yes, yes. All right. Let me do it the right way, baby. All right. Technical difficulties, but we got it together. I would like to introduce the Shop Talk listeners to author Monica Phillips. Her book is called This Is My Exodus. Now, today's topic, like I shared with you guys, is church hurt. I want her to kind of go into a little more detail, but I want to give you a quick synopsis of, you know, her book. And let me know if I'm on the right path, where she dealt with some things. Please get it. It's good. It's good. And I don't want to sound crazy saying it's good, because that's how I was with that Tina Turner. I was like, oh, that was a sad story, but it was really good. And yours was good, and I heard your testimony, and it's dealing with things that happened in the church, but you didn't leave.
No.
And that's what I like. And that's why I wanted to invite you on the show. So I would like to give her a Shop Talk welcome.
Thank you.
A round of applause.
Thank you.
You are quite welcome. So, Monica, can you tell us, give us your testimony, like, and condense it? I don't want to just give you time, but go ahead. You got the floor.
So, I will start with my backstory. I came from a big family, two-parent household, but my father, he was an alcoholic, and he was abusive to my mom and to the girls. We moved up here to Youngstown from Cincinnati, and my mom died at 12, okay? And later on, I found out my dad died 4 months later as well, when I was 12. But being that I was the youngest of nine children, Children's Service Board came in and took custody of me. And so they ripped me away from the rest of the family that I knew. They put me in a foster home, and I was a Kojic kid, Kojic Church of God in Christ.
Okay.
So they put me in a foster home with a church mother. She was over the pastor's age. You know how the Kojic family does. And so I was 12 turning 13. At the age of 13, one of the elders at this church started molesting me. I didn't know what it was at the time, but he was touching me. Those were the words that I used. I finally got up the courage to go and tell the pastor, because, you know, as children, if somebody's touching you inappropriately, go tell an adult.
Right.
I went and told the pastor that this elder was touching on me, and he said, okay, I want you to keep bringing me reports. And so I just kind of stood there trying to figure out what does that mean exactly, to keep bringing reports.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was looking for some backlash or a meeting or something with my foster mother and, you know, the man that was doing this to me, but that never happened. So every time I would get felt on, or the man filling my breasts or sticking his hand down my pants or up my dress, I would go and take the report to the pastor, because that's what he told me to do. Eventually, when I would take these reports, the pastor would say, what did he do this time? How did it feel? And did I like it? And I was telling him, no, can you make it stop? Eventually, it did not stop right away. What happened is the pastor himself started molesting me.
Okay. Let's put a period right on that, and let's go back a little bit. So the initial, because I want to give insight and help somebody that may be going through this. What was the initial introduction to the touching?
He was the choir director at the church. He was over the youth ministry at the church, and he would just kind of, you know, shove me, you know, acting like he was playing, you know, and things like that. He would shove me. And I was in love with one of the other boys, so all of that, it just didn't do nothing for me. But then he would, you know, started touching me, and it was uncomfortable. But prior to my mom dying, I was still playing with baby dolls, you know, playing tag and stuff like that. So I was not introduced to that type of stuff at all. Mm-hmm. I wasn't a fast girl, you know, none of that.
I get that part, and I want people to, you know, if that's their thought, they can go ahead. But we like to think, mm-hmm, that this is a positive platform. So looking at it as an innocent girl going to church,
mm-hmm,
choir director touches her, I'm trying to figure out the initial, like, you know what I mean? Because you'll have, like you said, he would touch you like he was playing.
Mm-hmm.
When did it get where he felt that he could, and not anything that you did, I'm not saying that,
mm-hmm,
where he could put his hand down your shirt? Like, I'm trying to understand that, so that if there is some young person, they need to know what to watch for before it gets that far.
Right. I think because I was trusted to his care from the church leaders and from my foster mother.
Okay.
That gave him, you know, that not a right, but almost like an okay to do what he was doing. And I remember he took me to the store one night and he kissed me. And I was, you know, kind of like moved. And I didn't know what to do with it. I was scared as heck. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
I was terrified. So I didn't know what to do with that. And so I just let it happen. And then and because I let it happen, because I was terrified, it kept going. But then when I got the courage to tell the help, which was the pastor, the pastor started helping himself to me.
Now that, I want to pause right there, because a lot of people don't understand when someone is has been molested and they're like, well, why is it they've been touched one time? Why are they letting it go on again?
Mm-hmm.
And people don't understand how so many different people can molest one person.
Right.
Okay, so you tell the pastor asks you all these questions, and then he decided he's going to help himself.
Right.
Man.
Right.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. So when, you know, again, I was a scared little girl who lost all of my family. To me, it was like my whole family had died, because once my mom died when I was, at 12, they took me away from the rest of my older siblings. So I was just, alone.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that played a lot into it, too, the trauma that I was already experiencing with the death of my mom.
Okay.
And pretty much the death of my family, because, they took me from the rest of my family. So when, now there was a boy there that was closer to my age. Now this happened between 13 and 14. Okay.
Okay.
So when I turned 14, this boy, he was 16. Okay. And he hated me. Him and his brothers, they was these fine boys. They didn't like anybody that looked like me, but I loved this boy. It was the light-skinned girls with long hair, or Spanish descent. That's what their choice of girls was.
Okay.
And so, but I just loved this boy. I was, a little dark-skinned girl, didn't have no hair, but the boy started talking to me, and I think he was kind of grooming me for what happened, because he took my virginity. Okay.
Okay.
And so I kind of latched on to him. I think I really latched on to him for security. I'm not sure how it goes, but when I got to the place where I can tell him about this pastor and this elder and what they were doing to me, I was crying. Like, he said, why did you, I said, I was scared. I was scared to say something. When I said something to the adult started helping himself to me. So it was just pretty much like, I'm doomed at this point.
Mm-hmm.
My mind, and I'm not sure why my mind never even allowed me to try to go tell another adult. My mind never even said, go tell another adult. And so, and then my sisters was like, well, why didn't you tell us? Because my sisters and my brother, they would have got it popping. But my mind just never went that way to tell anyone else. But when I told the boy, I believe we had a conversation with this pastor and with this elder, because after that, it stopped.
Okay.
It stopped. So now my loyalty is really to this boy that saved my life and saved me from the two bad men. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the pastor, he went on to other things. And so for a while, nothing happened with the elder, but he came over my house one night and he was able to do that because he was a part of the clique. My foster mother, she was the pastor's age. She was always throwing dinners, for the first family and things like that. And so there was one night he came over and he was allowed to. I told him that my foster mother was not home. But he came in and he told me that he heard what I told, you know, the boy about what he did. And so I was standing there, and this man had this dead-on look in his eyes. And he was probably like 30-something. He had this dead-on look in his eyes, and the man started wrestling me to the ground in my grandma, my foster mother's house. And I'm fighting him, trying to get away from him, and he literally wrestled me to the ground, twist my arm, and I fell on the ground. And that's when he literally penetrated me.
Wow.
I was 14. And so at this point, I really don't know what's happening to me, because I'm using words like rape and things now. But at that point, it was like, I don't even know what to call this. And so after he penetrated me, let his semen off in me, he got up and told me I better not tell nobody. And went and left out the door. So I'm sitting there just in shock. I was totally in shock as to what happened. So I sat on the floor. He wore this cologne that I literally just stopped smelling 3 years ago.
Wow.
Every time I would smell this cologne, I would dry heave. I would get sick, nauseated, and it would just come at me. So can you still hear me?
I can hear you. Go ahead. Oh, I can't now. Where'd you go?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. And so for just 3 years ago, I stopped smelling that smell. It was, I don't know, trauma. But anyway, I was sleeping. Now the elder has raped me. And when I started writing my book, it was then that I came to the conclusion that he raped me. I couldn't say it before. Mm-hmm. I think I was still in denial after all this time. But when I started writing my book, he raped me.
Did you ever tell your foster mom?
I told my foster mom, like I said, they would always have dinners and things like that. There was this one night, she had a dinner. Her, the pastor, and his wife was sitting at the table. She needed something from the store. And as soon as she said she needs something from the store, this elder was like, I'll go get it. You know, he jumped up. Come on, Ree. That's my nickname, Ree. Come on, Ree. And I'm standing with my back facing him, and I'm looking at these three adults. And I'm looking at them, begging them not to make me go to the store with this man.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying anything verbally, but I'm looking at them like, you know, shaking my head, don't make me go. And he said, come on, Ree. And my foster mother said, go ahead, Ree. Go ahead to the store. And she failed me, you know. So that was another night for me to be molested by this man. So they knew. Once Children's Service Board had found out what was going on in the home, they finally came and removed me from that house. They put me in a group home. And for a while, I started getting sick after a while. And it was like, oh, what's going on? So I just let it happen. I didn't know what was going on. Eventually, I started feeling something balling up in my stomach. And I told one of my house parents, is what we called them back then. I said, something is going on in my stomach. And she said, are you pregnant? I said, you know, I don't know. I'm 14. I don't know. I'm just, you know, doing these adult things, but I'm still a child. I don't know if I'm pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
But so they took me to get tested or get a pregnancy test. and I was confirmed to be 14 and pregnant.
Man.
So, of course, they asked who is the father, and I immediately said it was the boy. And that's who I talk about in my book. I named him the boy, the 16-year-old boy. So I guess they probably asked him. He said he had never touched me. He had never, that I guess they talked to the elder. And he said he had never touched me. So I pretty much had a holy conception because nobody touched me. At that point, I was going to North Junior High School pregnant. So they told me that I had to leave. So the Children's Service Board took me to a home in Pittsburgh. And that's where I stayed till I had my baby at 15. So I got pregnant at 14. I had my baby at 15. Prior to me having the baby, no one knew where I was. They didn't tell my family where I was. They pretty much just dropped me off at this unwed home for mothers, like you drop off a stray cat, you know, at the animal charity and never look back. That's pretty much how it was for me. So eventually the boy, I don't know how he found out where I was, but there were girls calling, telling me I'm a whore. You need to find your baby's father. Don't be blaming that on my boyfriend. It was so much until I had got to the point where I was contemplating suicide because the pain was so great. And I didn't want me or my baby to be here. That was one.
Lost her.
Can you hear me?
Now I can. Go ahead.
Okay, somebody's keep trying to call. I thought I put.
Oh, go ahead. Just keep going.
Do not disturb. But
go ahead. You know. Go ahead.
But nevertheless, after I had my baby, I was waiting to see her. You know, and once I had her, they whisked her out the room really quick. The nurses, they took the baby out the room. Really covered her face and just took out the room.
Okay, so the baby was going to be put up for adoption?
Well, that's what I'm getting to.
Okay.
So they took the baby out the room. And I said, well, can I see my baby? And they told me, well, you can't see her because we was under the impression that you were putting her up for adoption. Well, I don't know anything about adoption. I just had a baby. I was doing adult things, but I'm still a child, so I don't know anything about that. Now, so they didn't let me see her the first day, but the second day, the social worker came in and said, well, we were under the impression that you was putting her up for adoption. I didn't tell y'all that, because I don't know anything about it. They took me, after that, they took me back to Youngstown and put me in another group home, and I don't know when they came and got the baby. So probably a week went by. I didn't hear anything from the caseworkers. I'm still that scared 12-year-old child.
Right.
That's who I was. You know what I'm saying? So eventually they asked me, I had a meeting with them. They said, well, what are your plans for the baby? I said, well, I want to name her Breon. I'm going to ask my sister if she can take us until I turn 18. You know, I'm making plans. I'm telling y'all my plans. And so after I told them my plans, I'm sorry, I got sinus.
Go ahead. You all right?
After I told them my plans, the caseworker said, well, because you're in our custody and you're only 15, we think it's best for us to put this baby up for adoption. So Children's Service Board had already plan to put my baby up for adoption. So that's why the nurses were saying, well, we were under the impression. I didn't give y'all that impression because I didn't know anything about it. You know what I'm saying? So Children's Service Board had already signed, sealed, and delivered what was going to happen to the baby. Even after asking me what my plans was, they had already said it, because in the hospital, they told me we were under the impression that you was putting her for adoption. You see what I'm saying?
And I'm trying to understand. So since you were a ward of the state, they made the decision for you?
Correct.
Okay.
I was 15. I didn't have any choice in the matter. I was a child, and I was in their custody.
Okay, I have a question for you that you mentioned early on, and you said that it was the boy.
Uh-huh.
So were you protecting the church by not saying it was the elder? Or did you not, you really didn't know?
No, I honestly did not know.
Okay.
And I still don't know. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Like, I don't know if while I was having sex with the boy, I got pregnant. I was already pregnant.
Okay.
When the elder raped me.
Got you.
You see what I'm saying?
Got you.
So,
okay.
That's how that went. So they took the baby and put her up for adoption. And for 40 years, the devil called me a whore. Hope I can say that. 40 years, the tormenting thoughts came. Now, here's the thing. I ended up marrying the boy.
Okay.
And it was like, no matter what this boy did to me, I was loyal to him, because in my mind, he saved me.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever this boy did, I did it. But in the midst of that, he became one of my abusers. But it didn't matter, because he saved me from the bad men. There was...
When you say you married him and then he became one of your abusers, are we talking sexual or physical now?
Both.
Okay.
Both.
Okay.
Both. Now, you know, that's where my loyalty was. And you know, I believe that I had arrested development. Arrested development is something that happens through trauma.
Mm-hmm.
And your life just stopped. So my life stopped, you know. And even though I was, you know, born 15, 67, I was still that scared little girl that he saved from the bad men,
mm-hmm.
you know. So after I had the baby, after he denied the baby, after he said that he never touched me, all of those things, after I got back to the group home, I dust off my loyalty hat and I called him.
Okay.
I called him and asked if we could talk and things like that. And of course he said yes. And I found myself giving myself to him again. This time we was protected.
Okay.
Giving myself to him again. After all of that, I came back and I started giving myself to him. And it was like, he was training me to be a sad chick, okay? Because his preference of girls was light skin, long hair. I was nowhere near that. But he was sleeping with me, though. But he would only come and see me at night, you know, but he would go with the pretty girls in the daytime. And so when he was around people, I wasn't able to approach him or anything like that. I had to wait for him to approach me. And normally it wasn't at church, you know, it was after church at night.
So you were the secret because he wasn't okay with your appearance.
Correct.
You share with the listening audience how that made you feel?
Oh, I was hurt. It was horrible. I mean, he called me names, you black, ugly, cock at it, you know, I ate those thoughts for a lot of years, and you are what you eat. And so I started believing that I'm ugly. Yeah, I wear glasses. You know, I'm cockeyed, you know, these are the things that he would say to me. Nobody's going to want you. All you good for is a good screw, you know, and things like that. And so I was convinced that I didn't have no self-worth. I didn't have no love. Nobody would want me. I wasn't worthy to be on someone's arm. So I stayed with him.
Can I ask you this?
Yes.
So at night, he called you these names during the day, but at night when he came to you, did he ever give you an explanation as to why he treated you like that publicly? Did he ever?
Never. Okay. Never. And it's so crazy because he knew that I loved him. And I think the reason I loved him so much, but it happened before he saved me. You know, when I first went to this church, it was like, oh, wow. You know, it was like love at first sight.
Yeah, you shared that. Yeah.
I was 12 turning 13. So I don't know. But there was this one night, and he would drive the church van, right? So now I'm 16.
Oh, and he had wheels?
he drove the church van.
Okay.
So, I mean, this church was thriving. It's so crazy because it was thriving. You know, I really felt God in moments there as a teenager coming up.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, they had a lot of girls. So the girls would pack on a van and see who he's going on with tonight, you know, including me.
Okay.
Because I was just like that. I loved him. So there was this one night he was dropping everybody off and him and one of his guy friends was on the van. So mm-hmm. I'm thinking that, okay, they probably going to hang out. He's going to drop me off next. We started going down this dark road. And I looked up and fear hit me. I was like, okay. But then I was like, no, he's not. No, nothing's going to happen to me because I'm with him, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Eventually, we pulled over. His friend got out. I'm thinking he went to use the bathroom or something. And he came back there. I was on the last row. Of course, he wanted to have sex. It was okay because he saved me from the bad men.
Mm-hmm.
But I said, well, what about him? He's out there. Can you take him home first? He was like, nah, it's cool. So after he had sex with me, and I started getting myself, you know, getting myself back together, he said, stay right there. And I was like, for what? He like had my arm, and as I was trying to sit up, he subdued me, and with one hand, and then the other hand, he knocked on the window and told the friend to come in the van. So I'm saying, okay, this is not going to be good.
Uh-huh.
So they started, once again, I'm fighting for my life, and I'm looking at him like, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? And he was holding one of my legs. I had crossed my legs, you know, mm-hmm. I had a death grip, like
right.
Trying to, you know, what is going on here? So eventually they pried my legs apart. The boy got in position. Once he penetrated me, the boy, my savior, small s, he got out the van and allowed this boy to have sex with me.
Oh, man. Now, yeah. Were you guys married at that time?
No, I was 16.
You were 16.
I was 16.
And yeah. Then, so let's fast forward. So you end up marrying him, though?
I end up marrying him. Even after that, I ended up marrying him because my loyalty was, it was just there, you know, because he saved me. And so I ended up having four more children. And I say four more because I'm still hoping my daughter is his.
Okay.
I ended up having four more children from him, by him. And that's when it became more abusive, verbally and physically. I took a lot, but I loved him. He saved me. And that's where I was stuck at.
So you were still at the 14-year-old.
I was still at the 12-year-old.
12, okay.
13, 14, yes, where he saved me. And so, you know,
so when
the cheating, the cheating, the beatings, I stayed through it all.
When did you say enough is enough?
Oh, I said enough. Now, this is the crazy thing that happened. When we got married, this is how it happened. He called me one day and said, guess what? Guess what I'm doing? I said, what are you doing? He said, me and my sisters and my mother is planning our wedding. And I said, and I'm not there, you know. And he was like, no, all you just have to do is come and things like that. And I was like, okay, should I be happy? Because finally, after all of these years, I'm finally getting the man of my dreams, or what should I be here? So I chose to be mad, but I didn't say anything to him. I went through with it.
Okay, Amber D has a question.
Yes, ma'am.
No, I have tons of questions.
Go ahead. I see your face. Go ahead.
I should have brought a pen and paper at this point. But when you said, I don't know if you were at, like, you asked him if you should be happy, or you just weren't sure, like, emotionally how to respond to this, your dream guy and his mother's planning your wedding, but you not being involved in your own wedding.
Yeah, no, I didn't ask him. That's what I was saying to myself.
Okay.
Yeah, like, how should I feel about this? You know, my dream guy. But so it was horrible. I don't even call it a ceremony. I just called it a money. We had a money. It was horrible. It was horrible. But I found out later that one of his friends, and she was a mutual friend of ours, but she told me, she says, I don't want you to be looking stupid no more. I have to tell you something. And I said, okay. I'm probably like four kids in. And so she said, this boy, he had gotten in trouble with the case, and they had had a meeting with an attorney, and the attorney said, because I have the children, it'll look good if he married me, because it'll look good in front of the judge.
So it was for his own personal benefit, and you were still that person. And it, even when somebody says, hey, we're getting married, and you're like, huh, that's like no control of your own life. He was just controlling everything.
Yeah.
I got to ask you this, Monica, because my question, look, my mind is still stuck in the church van.
Okay.
Did he ever apologize to you for allowing his friend to have sex with you, pretty much rape you? Was that ever addressed, or did it just go away, or not in your mind, but did it just like keep going like the next day and nobody mentioned it?
Yeah, there was no mention, but I tell you what, about three or four years ago, I saw that boy that did that to me. And of course he's a man now. And in that moment, I literally started freaking out. Like, I was so scared in that moment when I saw him. I started looking for a way out of the store. Another way out than the front door.
Uh-huh.
And he asked me if he could talk to me. So I'm terrified, and I went outside. I said, okay, I made sure I was in 6 feet apart and things like that.
Uh-huh.
And he told me, he said, I want to apologize to you for what I did to you way back then. He says, I don't even know why I did it. He was like, the boy told me to do it, and I don't even know why I listened. So he asked me if I would forgive him, and I forgave him. So he was listening to my savior, you know, telling him to do that to me. So the boy never apologized, but the friend did about 3 years ago. And I didn't know how much trauma that caused me until I saw him in that moment, because I was scared to death. But when he apologized, it's like a weight just lifted. That, I mean, I sat in a car and I cried and I cried and I cried. But no, I never got an apology from the boy. No.
Okay, go ahead, Amber D. I know you can, go ahead with your other ones.
You were stuck in the bus, in the van. I was stuck in the very beginning, when you had went to the pastor to tell him what was happening to you, and he said to keep giving him reports. And to me, that was like the very beginning of things being wrong, because if you're in a position of being a mandatory reporter, like a teacher or something like that, that is not protocol at all. That is not correct. And then also to create the full structure of consent. In America, a child cannot consent to anything.
Right.
So him asking you, did you like it? Did you make it?
See, that bothered me too.
That is irrelevant. And so any child or minor person listening to this, an adult shouldn't be asking you how you felt about it, because that's irrelevant. It doesn't matter if you liked it, because we have bodily responses and nerves in our body. You liking it or, you know, it feeling nice is completely irrelevant. And an adult shouldn't be asking you that. Right. So if you go tell somebody that they're touching you and they're asking those kinds of questions, or they're saying, oh, well, just keep me informed, go find another adult to tell, because that's not right.
Yeah. Yeah. And it was, you know, and that's why I just kind of stood there, like my mind, everything was just so in turmoil in my life, you know. And it, like I said, my family, the Phillips, they would have got it popping. Chester Phillips, you know, my sister.
Yep, lost her.
Well, another call.
Another call. But you know what? Here's.
I don't know. I never even thought in my mind to tell another adult.
You know what? Can I say this? And I'm not trying to play psychologist, but even at the very beginning, from you being removed from your blood family, and I'm just listening, so now you're awarded a state, and now someone, you're a near care, your foster mother, and you said the role that she played at the church, it sounds like you were trying to protect your foster mother. And since she had that role, she was cooking for the first family, where it's almost like, and this is just me on the outside looking in, and just please let me know if I'm wrong. It sounds like, okay, I'm enduring these things. I told this person, I told the pastor, and then you stopped right there and you went back to where she cooks for the first family. So in all the different auxiliaries at the church, she was the one. And now you go to the store and you say she failed you. And it almost seems like you were protecting everybody around you that didn't protect you. Are you there? Did she go off again? Or that's what I need clarity on, being a child and protecting everybody else. What's your thoughts on that until she comes back, Amber D?
There is a guy on YouTube who talks about childhood trauma survivors. His whole platform is dedicated to it, and that is a very common response of childhood trauma survivors. I'm trying to pull up his name so other people can look it up, but that is very normal, where the child will be trying to protect the adult, and consequences befalling the adult. And honestly, from what I heard, and I don't know if she's gotten to that point yet, but I interpret her foster mother as being complicit, and almost, especially if you've learned anything about sex trafficking and the psychology behind it and how they're able to rope these young, usually young people into it. You know what I'm saying? But I just don't feel like, you know, and I'm trying to keep in mind the time frame, like things are different. And I like modern times, it's very unlikely for the state to take stewardship of a child, they will try to put the child with blood relative before, you know, taking custody of a child. But this was many years ago, so maybe it's different. But to me, it seems like the foster mother was more than complicit. She was an accomplice. Basically, failing to report is an accomplice, in my opinion.
And, you know, it's... I got to say, it happens more often than not. If you guys are interested in her book, it's called This Is My Exodus. This Is My Exodus. You guys check it out on, it's on Amazon. It's available on Amazon. The author is Monica Phillips. This happens so often. And go ahead. What you got, Amber D?
In the church.
Yes.
I want to add that. The church. And I'm going to add in the black church. And also something else as far as her...
Girl, you ain't about to... I can't let you do that. I can't let you say just in the black church because we already know about them altar boys and all that stuff. It's everywhere.
Everywhere. But I think people, especially black people, try to act like the black church is exempt. And it's not.
No.
And, in her story, the other thing that really spoke out to me is the lack of sex ed in all religious institutions.
Now,
we're not teaching young people how reproduction actually works.
Now, we did have that in school. It was part of our health. I really wasn't into it. Let me get this information again, because I see you, Nathan W. of YouTube, that said, is this book available? Again, yes, this book is available. It's called This Is My Exodus. You can get it. It's available on Amazon. And if you want to connect with her, with Monica Phillips, you can do so. This is her email address. It's connect, CONNECT, with, WITH, M, as in Monica, Phillips, that's a P, okay, MP, at yahoo.com. Or you guys can reach out to me and I'll lead you in the right direction, but get this book. She couldn't tell you all of it and how it turns out, which is good. And, you know, we just, you know, our show is 2 hours, but get the book. Find out what happens at the end. It's good. It's good. That's why I said I feel bad saying like it's a good book because it's her life. You know what I mean? Like, it's her testimony. It's her life. But baby, it's a good one. It is a good one. And to understand someone's path, I really hate the fact that even though we know colorism was a thing in the past and Monica's older than I am, so just when you think back and hear someone say what they felt like, that's why I asked that question. How did that make you feel where you had colorism? Like he publicly with the light skin, long hair girl, but privately he's with the dark skin, short hair girl. And that's what she actually shared. Now, Monica's beautiful. Now, if you see Monica, you're going to be like, oh, hold on. You know what I mean? And he had an issue, but that's how things were in the past. And we're trying to change that. Reboot your hard drive and change your way of thinking. But listen, if you feel as though that this show can help someone, please share it. Please share it. Because what they say, a picture is worth 1,000 words. Get the book, Amazon. This Is My Exodus. And just look through it and then read it. Okay. But sometimes when we hear things, that's why it was important for me to bring my book to the stage. When we hear things, you could connect. You could connect. I'm telling you. So if you want to reach out to her, connect with MP at yahoo.com. Y'all like the way I did that, right? That's how you can contact her. Connect with MP at yahoo.com. Just listen. It was just heart-wrenching just to hear that. You know what I mean? You can read it and you'd be like, oh, okay, blah, 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 blah. And then you have people-peopling. Like, why did you stay? Well, what? And then she brought it back to say, I'm still that 12, 13-year-old who was taken from my family. Like she said, her mom passed, and then it was like the death of her entire family. So I'm in this situation. And I know that question was, why choose me? Why choose me? You know what I'm saying? I know that would be a question in my mind. And we as people-peopling, not understanding, have the tendency, like she said, they were calling her whores. You know what I mean? It's like, come on.
Yeah.
So when, you know, you don't know what's going on, all you know is what's happening at the end or what the church, air quotes, is saying. And we know, us growing up in the church, you had that person that is like, oh, okay, yeah, that's the church hoe. But not knowing why they became that way. Monica, you back?
Yes.
Hey, there we go. All right. All right.
I'm sorry.
It is totally fine. So let me ask you this. Let me ask you this part. The after how long did you guys stay married?
Listen, I suppressed memories. It was so bad. I can't even tell you when I got married. I could tell you when I got divorced.
Okay, well, come on with the celebration. Come on with the celebration.
It was so bad, you know. And after the mutual friend told me that it was all because of his court stuff, and he didn't want to. And that's why I said the ceremony, it was just the money because it was horrible. They was fishing at the wedding. They was joking around at the wedding.
Wait a minute. What you mean fishing? What was it outside?
It was at the Mill Creek Log Cabin. But there's, you know, there's a creek over there.
Okay.
And, you know, the they was fishing, and you know, it was horrible. And when she told me what actually happened, I realized, oh, so he just did it to stay out of prison. So it was just a horrible thing that I allowed to happen. But I could have said no. I could have said no 1,000 times, but my heart failed me. My heart failed me because of what he did for me. I went on and married him, you know. And so
you saved him.
I saved him. And you know how there's a document that you have to take down to the courts in order to have a real marriage. In that moment, I thought, too, this is the time that I can get him back for everything he's done to me. But once again, my heart failed me because he saved me from the bad men. And so my loyalty, it just remained. And then eventually it was like, I'm done. My kids was more important to me.
Okay.
I love them more. And so I had to make peace within myself. And I walked away. So next weekend, I have a conference coming up.
Okay. We'll get to that. But let me ask you this. Without spoiling the end of the book. Did you ever find your daughter?
Yes. So, for 40 years, I buried the abuse, thinking that it was my fault. Even when I started writing the book, some people just started telling me from that denomination that it was my fault.
Mm-hmm.
From the Church of God in Christ denomination, saying I'm bashing the church, and that's not even my stance. And so I had the same conference last year, and I said, Lord, I'm still hurting. You know, I can't have this. I don't still have my daughter. I don't know where she is. I don't know her name. The day, one day after the conference last year, the conference ended Sunday, May 22nd. May 23rd, someone put me in touch with my daughter after 40 years.
How awesome.
Yes.
How awesome. So were you able to establish paternity?
Not yet. And I'm pretty much waiting for her because it was a lot for her too. You know, for being without me for 40 years,
uh-huh.
You know, and whatever her adoptive parents, you know, she, mm-hmm. she lived her life. She already had parents, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
I was more concerned with, I just want to see her. I just mm-hmm. want to be able to hug her. I want to be able to tell my story, you know, mm-hmm. because over the years, what was told to her, why mm-hmm. she
oh, was, yeah.
You
yeah.
know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So we're still, you know.
Y'all learning each other.
I
said you guys are learning each other, getting to know each other.
Yeah, it's
that's amazing.
I'm waiting for her. But you know, the most amazing part is God answered my prayer. I just wanted to see her again. I have grandkids. I have three grandkids. My oldest granddaughter, her name is Brianna. Brianna. And get this.
Wait, she didn't know who her mother was, and she did that?
Yes. Yes.
Wow. Okay.
Yes. And so in I remember I told y'all the caseworker asked me what were my plans. And I said I wanted to name her Breon.
Right.
So when we were still trying to figure out if this was my daughter, her grandson said, well, and I don't even know why he said, my grandson, I don't even know why he said this, but he said, her middle name is Breon.
Wow.
Yes. So I don't know if the caseworker had to have a moment of decency and said that this is the name that she was wanting to name her daughter, and the adoptive mother kept it as a middle name. And so I knew then, like, only God could have orchestrated something like this. And that was truly an exodus right there.
Definitely. Now, you have a conference coming up. Tell us about
it. Yes. So next weekend, Friday through Sunday, is the This Is My Exodus conference. It is totally free. It will be catered by Michelle and Food for Your Soul. Although everyone is welcome to come, it's tailor-made for those that have suffered any kind of abuse, including church hurt, spiritual abuse, molestation, and sexual abuse within the walls of the church. Because all of that connects us, because abuse is abuse is abuse. So
I need you to give us the address, because we have tons of listeners outside the recording area.
Okay.
So where is this conference located?
The conference will be at Sword of the Lord Global Ministries. It's 474 Early Road. That is the east side of Youngstown. Youngstown, Ohio. Yes.
Okay.
And
wait, again, what is it called? The Sword of the who?
Sword of the Lord.
Sword of the Lord. Okay.
Yep. Sword of the Lord.
Okay.
474 Early Road, Youngstown, Ohio, 44505.
And the time?
Friday, and each day is different. So Friday is the meet and greet starts at 5 to 7.
Okay.
And then 7:05, we're going into prayer with Elder Joshua Parham. He's from Pennsylvania.
Okay.
And we have Saturday, we have breakout sessions. We have different speakers that's going to speak on topics. It's not your fault. Self-love, self-worth, forgiveness, put something in the house. Church hurt and spiritual abuse.
Okay, so it's like support groups. It's like a conference for support groups, or
it's a conference, but it's not like a church conference, if you will. Now God is at the helm of it,
okay,
because He's our deliverer.
Uh huh.
But it's not a conference as you know it. But in worship, we have I have a prophetic praise team, Carthel Stevens, Mark Rains Jr. He will be, he will be one of the speakers, and also he will be ministry on the keyboard as well. Yeah. So
wait a minute, Monica, you singing?
Sunday.
Are you singing?
I'm singing.
Okay. All right. Now you can go ahead. All right. I'm going to show up then.
So the Lord gave me a song. It's called This Is My Exodus, a Survivor's Anthem. And I will be debuting that song on Sunday. That's the conference. The Exodus celebration is on Sunday at 3:00.
3:00.
So Friday,
meet and greet.
7 is meet and greet, and then service start at 7.
Okay.
Saturday at 3:00, we have a children's session.
Okay.
Because nobody left behind, right?
Right.
So Whitley Jennings will be teaching that session. It's called Good Touch, Bad Touch.
Okay.
So bring your children.
Okay.
And then Saturday also start the breakout sessions. We also want to have a mass deliverance service with Christina, Prophetess Christina Banner, you know.
Uh-huh. I know who you're talking about.
You already know.
I know who you're talking about. Yeah. So
we're going to have a mass deliverance service, buckets, paper towels, a trash bag. You know, we go in there because sometimes these things attach themselves to us. Hurt, you know, unforgiveness, bitterness, and things like that. We need deliverance. That's going to be Saturday. We also have a fire altar where we're going to be laying hands, prophesying, and pushing you into your exodus. Okay. Sunday, Apostle Tawanya Hicks will be our closer for that event. She's from Iowa, and that's where that starts at 3 o'clock.
Okay, so
each day is different.
Okay, so tell me this. I want to be clear because I don't want to confuse the listening audience.
Okay.
So it's, what's the name of the church? Sword of who?
Sword of the Lord.
Sword of the Lord.
Yes.
Early Road.
Yes. 474 Early Road.
474 Early Road. Yes. If you want more information on this conference, please contact Monica Phillips at connect, C-O-N-N-E-C-T, with MP at yahoo.com. I also would encourage you to bring your children.
Yes.
Bring your children. And for the youth that's there, and I hope you guys make that announcement as well. If it, you know, because I know I got the young people, because I talk to people from 8 to 80. Listen, yes, to Shop Talk with Mel. Contact Monica Phillips. If you have been touched and feel like your voice is not heard, contact Monica Phillips at connectwithmp@yahoo.com. Shoot her an email. Then that way you'll know somebody is listening. And even if you don't know what direction to go or who you can trust, this is her exodus. This is her testimony. And she is sharing with you what she went through. So if you feel as though nobody is listening, you're not the first.
Yes.
So my suggestion would be, please just reach out. That's our email. If you guys want to contact me, fine. I'll give you her information and lead you in the right direction. This must be stopped. It is so sad that over 80% of youth under the age of 18, it's over that, it's 83% to be exact, have been or are being molested within the church walls. Mm. And that's from all denominations.
Yeah.
So we got to do what we have to do. And it's so sad that even her situation where, okay, I'm telling somebody and then you like, oh, okay, well, let me take advantage of this. That's how I feel like with people who come out of abusive relationships. And I'll talk to people and I'm like, okay, don't tell your next person what you went through because they know how much you'll tolerate.
Right.
And what happens? And it's like, well, how do you go from one abusive relationship to the next abusive relationship? And you know what I mean? And this is how you have predators. And I don't want to put the misconception that all people in the church are bad. I don't want to put that out there.
Right.
And I also want for the preachers and pastors that's out there, because I know y'all, you know, you got the pop-up churches.
Yeah.
I need to say that this is a thing. You want to know, well, why aren't people coming to the church? They're not coming to the church because the church hurt.
Right.
And they don't know who to trust.
Right.
And let's be real. If I had heard your story, or if my experience was like yours, Monica, I got to tell you the truth. I'd be like, deuces, I'm out. All y'all. Bye. See ya. You know what I'm saying? And and you have people who are like let's mute R. Kelly. Personally, I'm just sharing me. Let's mute R. Kelly from the world. He's from the world. And I'm just put that out there. I don't know where his, you know, Christian stance is, but I'm just speaking. You're from the world and he's doing this. And then I'm supposed to go to Christ,
right,
where I'm supposed to be protected. And you're doing the same thing. We need to mute these pastors.
Horrible.
Go ahead, Amber D. What you got?
Well, I wanted to add on that, you know, you're not trying to make pastors look bad, but I would say you want to make people look bad who don't tell the truth, or people who stifle the truth.
Yes.
You know, or hide the truth.
Yes.
That's something that should be shamed. If that's what you're doing and that's how you're choosing to run your organization, you deserve to be held accountable. I'll also say, if you're a believer, and just like the one pastor we talked about, the gold chains pastor.
Yeah.
Congregation.
Huh?
You know what I'm saying? My critique of that situation was, where's his accreditation? You know what I'm saying? Like, right. So if you're considering a church and there is no accountability and there is no governing body and there is no structure, it's a red flag.
And it definitely is. And you see, one red flag is usually a parade to follow. But I will say this as well. You have people that are in the congregation of the church who I have seen. Now, this I've seen. Where just what Monica shared regarding, you know, oh, she's a whore or all that extra stuff. But you have older people in the church that you look up to that is quick to say who's fast and who's not and don't know right. The story, instead of saying, hey, you know, if you see that behavior, take them in and say, talk to me. Clearly right. Something must be wrong. Nobody is, and I'm not going to say everybody, but no one is saying, hey, there's an issue without categorizing the person. Nobody is taking that person in and was like, let me spend a little bit of time with you. What's going on? To see what's going on. Or if you see, and I'm a firm believer of this one, if you see a behavior that is familiar to you, usually you were that person, be like, listen, let me help you out, baby girl. I was going down this path. You know what I mean? Just talk instead of just forcing or projecting just because somebody is loud or... Because I was loud. I always spoke what I felt anyway. And it'd be right. Like, oh, okay, well, wait a minute. You in the guy's face. Oh, she must be fast. And that would, listen, and here's what, and I'm speaking for me. Fast, I wouldn't even bother with no dude. Yeah. But you had somebody over here quiet that was.
Right.
But whatever your thought is your thought. But if you see that there's an issue, or if you feel that way, just pray for that person. Or right. You have that person that's at the church and be like, that's my seat. And it's somebody new to come. Your seat, ma'am, I got a problem. If you've been coming here all the time, you good. You got a spot in heaven. Give your seat up to somebody else and maybe they can get a spot.
Right.
You know, so that church hurt. And that's why a lot of churches are empty now, because you're being prejudged. And that is where we need to stop.
Yeah.
What you got, Amber D? And then I'm going to let Monica go ahead.
And Monica had mentioned too, and you mentioned it, but just the terminology of fast, mm-hmm. you know, and I think this is a like a subculture thing
uh-huh. Because
in the greater culture, 12-year-olds, girls or boys are not seen as fast. They're seen as children. And it kind of folds into the sexualization of Black children. And regardless of what activity they're participating in, it cannot be consensual. So, and I think we have made progress as a community over the last couple decades, but it's still something that needs to be reminded mm-hmm. is that no, a 12-year-old, a 13-year-old cannot be fast.
Right.
That is a problem.
Right.
No, they don't have, a 12-year-old cannot have agency over their sexuality. That's not how that works. So we should completely divorce, you know, fastness mm-hmm. with minors and teenagers.
Yeah. You want to read that comment, Amber D?
Sure. So Nathan W. of YouTube said, I like to that Monica for sharing her story and still being standing, showing your strength through all of this, and you will be an inspiration to those who may be going through the same situation.
Thank you so much.
All right. Monica, you want to share where they can get your book?
Yes. It's on Amazon.com. It's also in the Kindle store. I also have some available here with me. And they will also be available at the conference on next weekend.
Okay. I want to thank you for coming on and sharing your story. And you have to come and visit with us again.
I will. I enjoyed it. Next time, the technical difficulties.
We'll get it together. We'll definitely.
Thank you all so very much for allowing me to share my story with you and your audience.
Absolutely. Let's give it up for author of This Is My Exodus, Monica Phillips.
Thank you.
All right. That was deep.
Very deep.
It was deep, and it needed to be shared. Now we got to get, look, I got to do the other part of the show, honey. Look, and get it going. I thank her for coming on. I'm telling you, it happens more often than not, and we aren't aware. You hear about it, and you're like, I don't know that person. I don't know this person, but it's happening right at home, in homes, new boyfriends coming along, fathers, like this. This was a thing, especially back in the day, and they just swept it up under the rug and like, oh, okay, they got a mental problem. We just be quiet and we keep our secrets here. We don't say anything. We just keep what goes on in this house stays in this house. Those days are over, especially with social media. So you have an outlet. You have an outlet. And if nobody is listening, go on and share your story. And it is not about getting attention, because some people feel like that. Oh, they just want attention. Call it what you want. You're just trying to conceal what you're doing wrong. Let's talk about fashion news. Guess what the color is this summer? The color. What you got? What you think?
I was going to say orange.
No, it's green.
Oh, okay.
It's green. It's green. All shades of green, lovely people. So when you get dressed this summer, think green. We think green. We think purity. We think health, growth, money. And most importantly, thinking green is new beginnings. Interesting, right? So make sure you guys go and tap into that green. That's like not the favorite color, you know what I mean, of people. You be like, green, that's your favorite color? Listen, green got it going on. Now, the FDA finalized the new risk-based rules for blood donors. How about that? Mm-hmm. Okay. So, like, there was a difference, in case you guys don't know, as far as, like, the questions. Mm-hmm. If you wanted to donate blood versus, you know, for your heterosexual and your gay community. Different questions. I'm happy that now they ask the same questions. You know, and they ask for the last 3 months. You know, they want to make sure all is well. What type of sex do you have? Do you have this? Do you have that? I did not know that there was a different, you know, there was different questions until I saw it.
Mm-hmm. I've seen that. I didn't know either. I guess it started in, you know, at the height of the AIDS epidemic. And
yeah, that was in 85.
And it was never changed.
Well, it needed to be changed because a lot of people doing a lot of things these days.
Right.
So let's do what we do. Remember we had Eugene on?
Yeah, exactly.
Come on.
Exactly.
You got to do what we got to do. Shout out to high school senior Dennis Barnes. Who's Dennis Barnes? If y'all don't know, y'all better get a grip. This is the 16-year-old who has 110 college offers, totaling $10+ million in scholarship. I'm hype.
Right.
I said that. Get your money. Get your education. Yeah. Do what you got to do. 110. I don't know if I would have applied.
Well, that's a lot of applications. But I wonder if, I mean, it must have been, you know, like, I'm going to do 10 a day or something.
But he ain't on social media. Right. You'll be like, huh? What? But a lot of them wanted him. So kudos to you, Dennis Malik Barnes. Okay. Okay, y'all figure that out. Look, you know I had to put that in there. What's up with the, they did the lottery. You know, I keep saying I want to, you know, hit the lotto, but I guess you got to play to hit it. And I just don't play. One day I'm going to do it. I might get lucky. The 26-year-old, you remember her in North Carolina who hit for $188 million, that Powerball? You remember that? I think we talked about this.
Yeah, I'm sure. And she, use the money to, like, get her boyfriend out of jail. All
this extra stuff, single mother. It was just 8 years ago.
And she's broke now?
Baby, listen. I don't know what she got going on, but they did the story, and this is the part that stuck out to me. Her pastor was the first one to come to her door.
Oh, I remember that. Yeah.
For tithes. Help me to understand. So, like, the lotto, like, we shouldn't be playing the lotto. We shouldn't be gambling, even though we know, like, Catholics do the bingo. Like, yeah. So, do you pay tithes off of lottery money.
I mean, if you want to, that's fine. But it was more than just the tithing. It was the other stuff she did, too.
No, that's the part that I'm on, though. That's my question. I mean, what she did with her gambling money don't have nothing to do with me. I just want to know, when the pastor knocked on the door and came for the tithes.
It's a red flag. That's what that is. But for him to come knock on the door is a red flag. If she felt moved by the Spirit to, you know, tithe of that money, then that's her business.
Or do you say where you got the money from?
Well, she was on the news, and that's why a lot of lotto winners be anonymous.
I would be anonymous.
Exactly.
I would so be anonymous. Mm-hmm. I would be anonymous. I ain't telling nobody.
Nobody.
Just watch the way I move. So if I'm like this, y'all see me on the show like this. Y'all know I hit, baby. I probably be telling everybody I hit.
Right.
But like, what y'all got? You'll be like, oh, she got a tech guy now. Ain't no, look, no technical difficulties. She must have hit for the millions, baby. I got staff.
Right, got that 4K camera.
Like, I got staff now. I got staff. Oh, man. Listen, it is a lot going on out there. I want you guys to keep that positive energy up. It's important to have positive energy. Wear your green. Wear your green. If you're feeling down, find some green. Look, go ahead, read that comment.
Oh, Salvage One, Salvage of You said, YouTube said, we did it, Joe.
what you got real quick? Go ahead before we lock out.
I did want to share with the listening audience. I did pull it up. So on YouTube, her platform is called The Crappy Childhood Fairy. And then another one is Patrick Tehan. And he is a licensed therapist, psychologist, and uh-huh. Both of them share a lot of great information about childhood trauma, understanding childhood trauma. So,
okay, go ahead.
So Denise Gibbs White of Facebook said, yes, she has a story and testimony. She spoke her truth. Everybody has a story, but some are ashamed to tell theirs because of what people will say. Never apologize for your truth.
And on that note, we gonna end that one. Okay, that was today's footnote. But I still have it. I still have it. Today's footnote. People, take it step by step. Ain't no sense in everybody tripping. All right. That is my time, lovely people. I thoroughly enjoyed you for tuning in to Shop Talk with Mel. Like us on all platforms and on your favorite podcast. You can listen to the show whenever you like, all at Shop Talk with Mel. Find you, embrace you. Most importantly, always, always love you. Until next week, people, you know what it is. Shop Talk! We're kidding. Enjoy your weekend, people. I love you for listening because I know that time is something we cannot get back.